Vulcan, the ninth planet that never existed. Vulcan was a hypothetical planet located between Mercury and the Sun, which, although many recognized, astronomers claimed it existed, was never seen by any telescope. What happened to this planet and why was it never found? Let's find out. Mercury is one of the closest planets to Earth, and records indicate that humanity has known its existence for hundreds of years. Still, during the 18th century, there was a problem with Mercury's orbit that astronomers could not explain. To better understand this, you should know that the planets have several movements around the Sun. The two best known are translation, the movement they make around the Sun, and rotation, which they rotate on themselves. But there are other movements. One of them is the precession of perihelion. This movement has to do with the planet's orbit. The planets revolve around the Sun, forming an ellipse, where one of the foci of that ellipse is the Sun. But the other focus is not static, but rotates slowly until it gives a complete turn to the Sun. This movement is present in all the planets, but in Mercury it is much more noticeable. And this is where the problem was. Since using physics and Newton's laws known until then, the observations indicated that the precession of the perihelion of Mercury was much greater than that obtained by making calculations. This is where the French mathematician Urbain Jean-Joseph Le Verrier makes his appearance. The most reputable astronomer. Le Verrier was a mathematician who was well known at that time. Thanks to his calculations, the planet Neptune was found. During those years, all astronomers knew that Uranus had an anomaly in its orbit, but no one knew why. Le Verrier theorized that this anomaly was due to probably an eighth planet, never seen before, pulling the orbit of Uranus. So using the known orbit of Uranus and comparing it with the orbit obtained only with the calculations determined how giant and where that hypothetical planet should be, then he sent that information to the astronomer Johann Gottfried Galle to look for that planet. That same night, he found the planet Neptune with a degree of precision that astonished the entire scientific community. After that feat, Le Verrier soon gained a reputation in the search for planets. So when he heard about Mercury's anomaly, he got to work. As with Uranus, he first determined the orbits of Mercury obtained with observations and calculations, and concluded that perhaps the same thing happened with Mercury. Thus, in 1859, he published his theory in which he proposed that if Neptune perturbed the orbit of Uranus, perhaps there was a small planet between the Sun and Mercury that perturbed the orbit of the latter. The law said so. The law of universal gravitation had explained the celestial movement of the stars without a doubt for two centuries, and according to that theoretical framework, the only thing that could explain the orbit of Mercury, one of the most disturbing phenomena in the solar system, was the existence of a planet hitherto unsighted. Le Verrier proposed that a planet or a group of more minor planets circulating near the Sun would be sufficient to produce the abnormal disturbance measured on Mercury. For astronomers of the time, this theory had made sense, mainly because it was proposed by someone with a reputation as high as Le Verrier. Soon, this hypothetical planet was named Vulcan, in honor of the Greek goddess Hephaestus, the divine blacksmith, which alludes to its proximity to the Sun. As soon as the news was published, immediately astronomers worldwide began to look for the planet that should be between Mercury and the Sun. Still, it wasn't easy to find, since the Sun is too bright and dazzles the telescopes that point at it. This hypothetical planet would be so close to the Sun that it could only be seen during total eclipses, or if it passed directly between the Earth and the Sun, when it would appear as a dark circle running in a straight line from west to east, the face of our star. The next eclipse was not far away, July 1860. However, until the mercurial anomaly was satisfactorily explained, the cosmos would remain in disorder, and it was preferable to find Vulcan as soon as possible. Vulcan exists. An amateur doctor of astronomy named Edmond Modeste Lescarbot, a few months earlier, had observed a black dot passing in front of the Sun with his telescope. They noted the transit's size, speed, and duration. Months later, after reading about Le Verrier's hypothetical planet, he sent him a letter with all the details. The renowned astronomer visited, reviewed the equipment and doctor's notes, and excitedly announced the discovery of Vulcan in the early 1860s. However, independent confirmation from a professional was still necessary, and the new planet was tremendously challenging to spot. Although many, frustrated, began to doubt its existence, Vulcan became one of the most sought-after celestial bodies in astronomy, and surprisingly, many began to find it. Over the years, there were sightings of respected amateurs and astronomers. Their existence was confirmed and denied several times. The media spread the news of their presence more than once, and speculation persisted until the 20th century. Even the New York Times of 1876 published, "Vulcan exists, and its existence can no longer be denied or ignored." So that very soon it officially became the ninth planet of the solar system, or rather, the first, since Vulcan, the new order of the planets, placed Vulcan as the first, Mercury as the second, Venus third, and Earth was no longer the third planet, but the fourth. This idea gained so much traction that the science books of the time began to print the new image of the solar system in which Vulcan could be seen as the first planet and not Mercury. The hunt for the new planet begins. Although the planet Vulcan had already become famous thanks to Le Verrier and amateur astronomers who swore to have seen it, the most skeptical remained doubtful since the observations the amateurs gave did not seem convincing and, above all, did not confirm to the calculations. So, to get out of doubt soon, observational astronomers began searching for this planet with the most powerful telescopes of the time. After the total eclipse of July 1860 observed from Spain, in which the planet was not sighted despite instrumental and photographic improvements, the German astronomer Christian Heinrich Friedrich Peters confessed to the press, "I refuse to waste time looking for the mythical birds of Le Verrier," indicating that the hypothetical planet proposed by the mathematician did not exist. After the death of Le Verrier on September 23, 1877, the existence of Vulcan was in danger by losing such vital support. The climax of his fruitless search came with the total solar eclipse of July 29, 1878, visible in the United States. Many American astronomers moved their instruments, clocks, and cameras throughout much of the National Geography to systematically sweep the solar surroundings. In one of the main expeditions, led by astronomer James Craig Watson in the city of Rawlings, Wyoming, Thomas Alva Edison himself was not only to attend the event but to test one of his new inventions, the thermometer, very sensitive to solar heat. Another no less critical team led by Simon Newcomb settled in Separation, Wyoming, not far from the previous team. Although the observations were neither definitive nor clear due to the large solar corona, Watson was convinced that he had observed not one but two planets right between the Sun and Mercury for the rest of his life. These observations were criticized by Peters, who claimed that they were only the stars Theta Cancri and Zeta Cancri. During the next expedition to observe a new total solar eclipse in 1883, the astronomer Edward S. Holden, Watson's successor, again made delicate observations of the solar vicinity, but was unsuccessful in the search despite instrumental improvements. Einstein killed Vulcan. Vulcan's genuine or imagined existence ended at the Prussian Academy of Sciences in 1915, when Albert Einstein explained the famous theory of general relativity, in which he explained his view of the universe and the new idea of space-time. Einstein explained that the variations in orbit of Mercury were not produced by any planet, but rather as a byproduct of the gravitational force of the Sun, since it has an enormous mass that bends the space-time around it by bending the light of the objects that surround it, both stars and planets, especially from the planet closest to the Sun, Mercury. 4 years later, the explorer Arthur Eddington traveled to the island of Principe, near Africa, to observe the solar eclipse of May 29, 1919. During the eclipse, he photographed the stars that appeared around the Sun. According to Einstein's theory of general relativity, stars that would be observed near the Sun should be somewhat displaced, because the solar gravitational field bends their light. This effect can only be observed during an eclipse. Otherwise, the brightness of the sun makes the stars invisible to the human eye. Eddington's observations confirmed 100% Einstein's theory. They were taken in his time as proof of the validity of general relativity, making Albert Einstein famous instantly, since his equations predicted the orbit of Mercury, as well as those of the rest of the planets, with unprecedented accuracy. From this moment, the scientific community immediately ruled out the existence of Vulcan. Mercury returned to take its place as the closest planet to the Sun, and the solar system again had 8 planets. Debunking the existence of Vulcan was central to Einstein, because it showed that this strange and radically new idea of his, that space-time flows, were the right way to see the universe. What happened to the times Vulcan was seen by other astronomers? According to the observations, it is likely that astronomers who swore to have seen Vulcan was not hallucinating or had a spot on their telescopes. Everything seems to indicate that what astronomers of the time observed were sunspots. At that time, it was unknown that the sun could have spots, but today we know that these can appear suddenly and without warning in some areas of the solar surface. So perhaps what astronomers saw was that. Today we are no longer looking for any planet between the sun and Mercury's orbit. However, we are still looking for Planet 9, which is also based on mathematical speculations from gravitational perturbations of objects in the most distant areas of the solar system. You could say that the search for Planet 9 is the new version of Vulcan, a planet that probably does not exist, but that calculations indicate it is there. Vulcan may have been ejected from our solar system, but it may also be that we will find a Vulcan or two somewhere else very soon. What do you think? Do you think there is a 9th planet in the solar system that we haven't seen yet? Let us know your opinion in the comments.